Selamat sore.
Selamat sore.
First of all, I'd like to thank the organizers for inviting me here today to share with you the experiences of universal health coverage in Malaysia. Now, Malaysia is a country located in the Asia Pacific region, sandwiched between Thailand to the north, Singapore and Indonesia to the south. It's home to about 30 million over people, different ethnic groups practicing different religions. Economic growth over the past few decades has enabled sustained investment in social infrastructure, including schools and health facilities. Now, our public healthcare system, which I'm going to elaborate at length today, which is the backbone of our delivery of healthcare in Malaysia, okay, provides comprehensive healthcare services with minimal fees, okay, because healthcare, public healthcare is funded with by general taxation. It is this public healthcare system that we have in Malaysia that leads to the country's claims to have achieved universal health coverage, not like Philippines lately, not like Indonesia trying to do, not like Thailand have done in the 2000s, but in the 1980s. This, ladies and gentlemen, is how primary care is delivered in the public system. Let me see how I can. This, a community clinic, is established for a population of between 2,000 to 4,000 people. This clinic is staffed by doctors, community nurses, as well as medical assistants, and the clinic is equipped to give preventive and promotive care like vaccinations, antenatal checks, as well as clinical management for uncomplicated medical conditions. Anything more complicated than that, they will refer to the health center. The health center is established each for a population coverage of about 15,000 people. And in this health center, you will find primary care specialists, dentists, pharmacists, you will find labs, you will get rehab services. Okay? And the thing to note is, because this primary care delivery system is mainly financed from general taxation, each person using this outpatient services is asked to pay just one Malaysian ringgit. That's equivalent to American 30 cents, Australian roughly 30 cents. And look, for this one ringgit or 30 cents, what would a patient get? Medical consultation, either by a doctor or a medical assistant, lab investigation, simple lab investigation, mind you, even x-rays and medication, right, for 2 weeks. Now, it is here in this health center that the services for screening, HIV counseling, and management for HIV follow-up cases is being provided. Malaysia, the public system, I'm focusing on the public system here, enables a patient to be referred and to access primary, secondary, and tertiary care. We have a formalized referral system, which, sorry, I'm not a techie. So, allows a patient to be referred upwards through facilities of increasing sophistication. Okay, what you have here, primary care from the rural community clinics like I mentioned before, to district hospitals, to state and regional hospitals, up to national referral centers, like we have National Heart Center, National Cancer Centers, but the national referral centers are mainly located in the Klang Valley. Okay. Public care is not the only type of care available in Malaysia. A patient in Malaysia is actually able to choose to obtain care in the public sector or the private sector. Okay. Now we have, unlike the experiences with the Thai colleagues, because of this system, and perhaps I'll elaborate a bit later, it is not impossible for NGOs or civil society organizations to tap into taxation funding for services. And perhaps we'll talk about that a bit later. Now, remember, Malaysia, a person can choose public or private care. So in 2011, we've done studies, and it was noted that there was about 4.4 outpatient visits per person in Malaysia. And about half of these visits were to public facilities. Now, at the same time, there was about 86 hospital admissions. Bear in mind, private hospital admissions can be darn expensive. So only about a quarter of hospital admissions were to private hospitals. Bear in mind, in Malaysia, public and private care is financed through different mechanisms. I have mentioned, public care is mainly financed through general taxation. Fees are minimal. Private care is mainly financed through out-of-pocket payments. Okay? In 2015, Malaysia spent roughly about $14 billion, or about 4.6% of the country's GDP on health. Half of this came from public sources. But what is of increasing concern is that one-third of the total health expenditures in the country came out of pocket. Now, why am I focusing on out-of-pocket payment? Out-of-pocket payment deserves very special attention. Out-of-pocket payment essentially means payment for health care from savings. And you can just imagine, a poor person may not have a lot of savings. So reliance on out-of-pocket payment for health care can have more negative welfare impact on poorer households than richer households. But having said all that, despite one-third of our total health expenditures being on health out-of-pocket payments, we have done studies to show that out-of-pocket payment for healthcare remains a very small portion of the average household's expenses overall. In general, it's less than 2%. So, in short, what I'm trying to say is, we've got a very good public healthcare system, has contributed to universal health coverage. Our health indicators, if you look here, including life expectancies, maternal mortality, infant mortality, are on par or even better than any other country with in the upper middle income group. Am I going to end my presentation here?
No.
It's challenging.
Nothing's perfect.
Nothing's perfect, you're right. So I was sharing with some of you my journey through universal health coverage. I'm sure you can gather it's my passion. The first part of my career has been to document, I never question, to document the achievement of universal health coverage in Malaysia. It is only after that I discovered the gaps. Demographics, the structure and organization of our population has been changing over time. And what we are finding now, like in many countries, we are still a young country, young population, but we are growing older. In particular, the population is getting bigger, 28,000 in 2010, expected to reach over 28 million in 2010. Our population is projected to more than 40 million by 2040. But more important is that the proportion of those aged 65 and above will nearly triple during that time. And this has implications on health demand for healthcare. Next thing, just like many countries in this region, rapid urbanization. In 1960, only a quarter of our population actually lived in urban areas. By 2015, three quarters of the Malaysian population are now residing in urban areas. This actually places a huge strain on the government trying to provide basic amenities, schooling, affordable housing is currently a huge political issue, as well as healthcare. Now, I described, and some of you may say I boasted about our perfect primary, public primary healthcare delivery system. It's not perfect. The well-organized structure I described just now is well-developed in the rural areas because we started developing our primary care system way back after, just after independence from British rule. That was the time when most of our population were living in the rural areas. So that was the focus of attention. Our efforts to try to duplicate such organizations in the urban areas have not really met with full success. So affordable primary health care in urban areas is now becoming an issue. Okay? Patterns of diseases have also changed. We are slowly changing from communicable diseases to non-communicable diseases. By 2012, we noted that mortality from non-communicable diseases is nearly five times that for communicable diseases. 2015, okay, prevalence of diabetes among our adults aged 18 and above is 17%. We consider that an epidemic. And for the same adult group, population group, nearly a third of them had hypertension. So what I'm trying to say here is that the integrity of our public healthcare system is being challenged. It's being challenged by changing demographics, by changing disease patterns, and if I may say so, unstable economic situation, right? So the fear is that the public sector, in trying to still maintain accessibility and affordable care, may have, I would say, sacrificed some aspects of quality and comprehensive care. Okay, and this definitely will impact on universal health coverage in Malaysia. Let me just go on to a few areas of concern just to illustrate this point. Right. Over successive national household health surveys, we have noted that the prevalence of diabetes have been growing year after year after year. But what is more of importance and concern to us is this. Sorry. Is that the proportion of those undiagnosed diabetics, people who did not even know they had diabetics, is growing at a much faster pace than those who knew their condition. Okay? In 2015, more than half of the diabetics did not even know they had diabetes. Okay? This points to the fact that the public system need to look and review how we screen, we provide health screening to our population. Currently, this is done opportunistically. This may not be the perfect way to do screening for the general population. The public system that we described just now may not have full capacity to screen all types of conditions, whether it is non-communicable or HIV. And this, I would like to point out, is perhaps where civil society can come in to help. We have talked about this whole morning, actually. The system in Malaysia definitely needs to invest and commitment, research to find out why people are not accessing care. Free care does not necessarily guarantee use of services. We need to find out why services are perhaps not acceptable to those in need. We all know in this room that healthcare is but one determinant of use of healthcare is but one determinant for good health. There are many, many, many other social and biological determinants. We know that. But you also must accept that the use and receipt of needed care can help decrease disparities between the poor and rich. Okay? I don't think anybody here would dispute that. However, even though Malaysia has achieved universal health coverage for decades, we still find this. Let me take you through this. Sorry. Got it. Maps of Peninsular Malaysia. They are the districts in Peninsular Malaysia. At the time this was done, some 86 districts. The darker the district, the poorer the district. So you will find the poorer districts north and in the east coast of Peninsular Malaysia. The circles actually depicts premature mortality. Okay, and the bigger the blue circles for the boys, and the red circles for the girls. Okay, the bigger the circle, the higher the burden. Look at it. Big circles among poorer districts. This is Klang Valley, tiny circles, right? So despite universal health coverage is not the answer. A lot more things have to be done. Despite universal health coverage, we still have this disparity, inequity in the distribution of health. And perhaps this is another area where civil society can come step in to advocate better allocation of resources to those in need. To me, this is one of the biggest worries, that Malaysia is slowly moving away from the welfare ideology that underpins the development of the primary healthcare system in the first place, towards more competition, pro-market health sector. This is talks about a relatively new policy where health fees, hospital fees and the rest are being raised for non-citizens or non-residents. Okay? These sort of policies may have been caused by economic concerns, and I won't need to go into that, but it does mean that access to care for foreign residents and either other vulnerable subpopulations may be affected. And this is again another area where I would strongly advocate, now I'm doing the advocacy here, for civil society to come step in and help the vulnerable populations. In short, the Malaysian public healthcare system has done well in the past. No one can argue that it has not helped the country to achieve universal health coverage. But the question is, can this be sustained in the face of all the challenges due to demographics, changing disease patterns, economic situation? My worry again is if that the public system, if it cannot cope, people in Malaysia will be forced to buy private care, and potentially, this is very expensive. And if they cannot afford it, they may need to forego needed care. The primary healthcare system in Malaysia needs to expand its capacity, to provide for growing and increasing health needs of the population. Where these resources are coming from is open to debate. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Chiuman. This is also another very, giving us another perception and another perspective from Malaysia. So we can see that actually in the past, Malaysia has already started for the UHC. And if maybe from Indonesia College C, you can see the national referral systems and might be the same like in JKN. Yeah. And then I'm not what professor mentioned about the related on the coverage of ART. It is free for Malaysia, but not many of people living with HIV access it. So free doesn't mean that everyone will access. And there is another challenge that faced by the Malaysia. And then the other session about the question and answer, I will give it to Mara. Mara, please.
Good afternoon. Magandang hapon. Salamat.
Sorry.
Okay. We'd like to open the floor for questions or comments on the two presentations. May I invite Dr. Pandep and Professor Chiuman to please come in front? Yes, Heath.
Thank you for the great presentations. Sorry, it's Heath from Sydney here. I just wanted to ask a question about the Malaysian situation. So just to clarify, someone who is living with HIV can get first-line treatment for free, but obviously someone living with HIV may need continued healthcare, screening for viral load, CD4 count testing, they might have multiple morbidities. Does the coverage in Malaysia extend to the provision of health services that are associated with living with HIV?
Okay, are there any more questions or comments at this time before we ask Professor? Can we have all the questions from the people raising their hands first before we go to the responses? Greg, Jonas, and Jenny.
I'd just like to maybe get feedback from the two presenters in terms of where they see the value of social contracting, because I'm hearing that there are challenges within the current Thailand system, there are restrictions, but you cannot actually engage communities to do the much needed work around prevention. But also in Malaysia, it seems that we're not doing sufficient to really ensure that the communities are out there actually trying to bring in people to get tested and treated.
Jonas?
My question is on financing. Given that both schemes are actually funded directly through government subsidies, are there spaces within government budget cycles where communities can actually advocate for increased public investment?
Thank you. My question goes to the speaker, excellent speaker from Thailand, but relevant to Malaysia. So in your presentation, you mentioned about the strategic plan in Thailand, which is from 2017 to 2022. So this strategic plan aims to have UHC cover everyone who lives in Thailand. So everyone who lives in Thailand, does this include migrants from other countries who lives in Thailand? But actually what I learned from Tina before is that you only have a special insurance which covers migrants. From other countries, but if this insurance covers migrants from other countries who's living with HIV, and how does it work? And this, I think this is relevant to the presentation from Malaysia, which talk about the foreign residents. So does Thailand has any good practice in terms of covering migrants, which can be introduced to Malaysia or other countries?
Thank you, Jenny. Okay, so the first question was about whether
the HIV related coverage under the UHC scheme in Malaysia also covers other comorbidities of HIV other than ART. The second question was about whether the UHC schemes also have strategies to reach out to communities who are not utilizing the service. The third one is about financing. And the fourth one was about migrants in particular. Doctor, who wants to go first? I think the first question was directed to Professor Chuan, so can we see?
I'll jumble all four questions. All right. Perhaps Jonas first,
yeah.
Along the flow. Our public system is financed through general taxation. It's bureaucratic. Annual budgets will be debated in parliament. Okay, prior to that, each ministry prepares its request for budgets. Now, you're asking whether this can be increased. Definitely. Excuse me. But also understand that the entire process is political. Okay? So next question is there room for civil society to influence this process? Definitely. Understand also this process is political. Okay, I think I've answered that question. The services being provided by the public system is comprehensive. I highlighted ART because of the audience today, but a person living with HIV would be considered like any other Malaysian in the public system. So if the person requires preventive care, vaccinations, right down to chest x-ray to detect TB, right up to maybe admission for pneumonia, even higher for, let's say, appendicitis would be covered. Right. Migrants is a highly politically sensitive issue. The reason why the policy came into being, because there were heavy and of large proportion of migrants or foreign residents in the hospital system, and so the ministry, against the backdrop of economic constraints, came about to put in this policy. Okay, how to improve the situation again? It is political, and advocacy is really very much needed. I am not just advocating for foreign residents, but for all vulnerable subpopulations. These include Orang Asli, our indigenous groups in Malaysia, who are marginalized, and the poor. You've seen some of the findings of my students, where the premature mortality being higher. That should not be the case. I've mentioned many areas where CSOs or civil society can come in. I think because of the funding structure, like I said, it's a little bit better than Thailand. Thailand is constrained by the law, not being able to fund civil society. But Malaysia being taxation, and in fact, Anu would back me up by saying that civil society is being funded through taxation, through the Ministry of Health. Can this be increased? It's bureaucratic and political. So I think you know the answer.
About the migrant HIV in Thailand, I think that is the big problem. We classify the migrant into groups. The first group is the worker, that formal worker, that legally. And the second group is the unidentified group. Yes, for the first group, we have the system that looks like the health card at the same at the previous day of the system of Thailand. So this group have to pay the fee for health service. And after they pay, they can receive ARV or LT in the hospital that they pay the card to them. But for the second group, we cannot identify who are them, and they cannot go to receive the ARV in the hospital, except they go to the private sector and pay by themselves.
Okay, thank you. Okay, second round of questions or comments? Yes. And Varia, yeah.
just to mention that for Thailand, from the civil society, is the although that the bigger laws in Thailand prohibits the government to fund the CSO. But since we use the very formal French legal system, which is means that whatever is written in the laws, it's difficult to be changed. So that's why we NHSO goes around by having the small regulation within the NHSO to bypass the bigger laws, but it's still in the gray area. It's still that regulation is still illegal if we consider the bigger law. So this is the something that Thailand has been experiencing, just to comment on that. But in terms of the migrants, actually, I love the lots of questions from lots of migrants in Thailand here. and the thing is, as Dr. Pantay mentioned, is there are both documented and undocumented. Yes. For the documented one, they're fine. But the thing is, the migrant fund in Thailand was established because of the both of the employer and employees do not want to pay in advance. Because they were supposed to be incorporated into the Social Security Fund, which is paid tripartite. But then again, they don't want to pay, employees don't want to pay, so they will pay only when they get sick. So this is a problem because it means that the basics of the health insurance won't work, because if you don't get sick, you not go to the hospital and pay. If you pay it and then you receive ARV, it means that the money has to come out from somewhere. So this is something that the CSO are trying to work on the best to improve the living status of the migrant workers. But we're talking about the supply and demand a lot about the service provision. But actually, it's more about the attitudes of other stakeholders in the country as well. Because when Dr. Pantay also mentioned, and we experienced that, a great deal of the extended government stakeholders, they mentioned that we don't even cover most Thai people, so why do we need to care about non-Thai nationals, or why do we need to care about migrants? So shouldn't we pay more attention to Thai nationals rather than giving money to someone else? So this is something that it could be driven as the regional advocacy together, and that would be my suggestion. Thank you.
Thank you, Omba.
I'm sorry, I have a question in Bahasa. Pertanyaan saya ajukan untuk Profesor to Malaysia. Pertama, capaian UHC di Malaysia, saya kira itu sebuah hal yang juga perlu kita apresiasi juga. Tapi pertanyaan pertama adalah strategi yang paling terdokumentasi dari keberhasilan UHC ini, sebenarnya peran yang paling besar itu diperankan oleh siapa? Apakah oleh parlemen ataukah oleh populasi kunci dan juga civil society-nya? Karena kalau tadi kembali kepada yang disampaikan bahwa sebenarnya segala policy yang ada di Malaysia itu juga ada ujung dalam keputusan politik. Dan pertanyaan kedua, sehubungan dengan isu coverage UHC untuk pekerja migran, karena kebetulan saya pernah bekerja 2 tahun di Malaysia, ada persoalan sebenarnya soal undocument dan dokumen. Jadi ada pekerja yang kemudian dianggap sebagai pekerja legal dan ilegal. Nah, bagaimana kemudian strategi UHC ini di dalam mengcover para pekerja migran yang kemudian memiliki persoalan undocument? Karena beberapa pengalaman di Malaysia ketika memang pekerjaan dokumen itu juga mengalami persoalan yang sebenarnya tadi hampir mirip disampaikan oleh Om, keterkaitannya dengan akses terhadap UHC dan ini advokasinya ternyata juga cukup berat untuk kita lakukan di Malaysia.
Terima kasih.
Okay, the first question was, I talked about the political influence on development of universal health coverage, and the question was, which party was the prime mover for development and achievement of universal health coverage in Malaysia? Is it the politicians or civil society? I'm a lecturer. I can talk to you till the cows come home if you want. The answer lies in our history. Okay? We achieve, so you have to forgive me because it didn't come from me. We were a former British colony. We achieved independence in 1957 and became the Federation of Malaya. Since then, at that time when the local government took over the governance of the country, like I said, the welfare philosophy which we inherited from the British I wouldn't say the colonizing forces. But there were some good points from that point in time in history. One of which was the sharing of this welfare philosophy. And because of that, and we inherited at that point a health system that looked like NHS of old. Okay? So the focus was to provide healthcare to the rural population because that's where most of the people lived. So if you were to ask me who was the prime mover to achieve universal healthcare in Malaysia, I must say that it was the government of the day during that time, and it has moved over time. The next question, I skimmed over, yes, in one slide. Provision of healthcare in Malaysia for migrants. Undocumented migrants is a big population. Okay, they are very vulnerable to exploitation, not just from healthcare, welfare, other welfare benefits, social benefits. The documented migrant is also another big population in Malaysia. There have been policies in the recent past where documented migrants require health insurance to come to work in Malaysia, and this will give them access to the public healthcare system that I spoke of. The issue is with the undocumented migrants. This is politically sensitive. There are horror stories to be shared, but perhaps not on camera. But suffice to say that this is an area where advocacy for better rights need to be done.
Thank you so much. Unfortunately, we don't have enough time for more questions. I will not attempt to synthesize what has been discussed, but I would want to reiterate two important points. And that is, one, when we talk about UHC, for me, one of the more important concepts is the concept of universality. And it keeps coming out that even though services are available, even though services are free, it does not guarantee that they will be utilized. And that is because people, the communities that we want to serve, are not always standing on the same ground. There are always communities who are more marginalized, whether it's because they're not citizens or they're foreigners, whether because they're undocumented, whether because they are socially marginalized or they are criminalized. And for us to really achieve universal health coverage, I think it needs to be embedded in our healthcare systems as well as in our universal health coverage schemes, the strategies that would reach out, that would equitably reach out to the communities that are underserved and are finding it hard to actually access the available services that we have. And the other The other point that I wanted to also reiterate, and I thank Professor Juwan for this, because she keeps reiterating the value of advocacy, and that is our that's really our job to push. As Jonah said this morning, the people need to demand and expect universal health coverage from their governments. And it is our job, and I thank you for leaving us that message. We need to move forward from this. And as with all forums, it will end today, but the work doesn't. So we'll continue doing advocacy, picking up on the lessons that we've heard today. So thank you very much to our speakers for the very valuable inputs, and thank you for those who share their insights and questions. Thank you so much.
Terima kasih.